Hi, everyone. Welcome to an exciting day. For those of you who I haven't had the gift of getting to know, my name is Kim St. Martin, and I'm the Assistant Director for Michigan's Multi-Tiered System of Support Technical Assistance Center. And we are in for a wonderful treat today. It is a gift to be able to introduce you to our presenter, Dr. Louisa Moats. And I'm going to introduce Dr. Louisa Moats. And I think actually I'm going to do one quick housekeeping thing because Melissa wanted me to make sure all of our Michigan colleagues who are interested in receiving sketches for today's session, please download the sketch form from the email that was sent out last week or from the chat box in our webinar. And I think Melissa is going to continue to add that to the chat box so that people could, who came in after it was already put in the chat box, can access it. So you're going to need to complete the sketch application and return it to Miranda Miller, and her email address, your mmiller@mimtss.org, within 1 week of today's event. So you must be present for the entire 2 hours in order to qualify for the sketches. So that's our one piece of housekeeping. But now for the main event. I have the gift of being able to introduce you to Dr. Louisa Moats, who is here talking about how teaching reading is rocket science, what expert teachers of reading know and do. Dr. Moats has been a teacher, a psychologist, researcher, graduate school faculty member, and an author of many influential scientific journal articles, books, and policy papers on the topic of reading, spelling, language, and teacher preparation. So it is a gift to have Dr. Moats with us. Without further ado, welcome Dr. Moats. Thank you for being here.
Yeah, thank you so much, Kim. It's a pleasure to be able to have this hour plus with all of you in Michigan. First of all, I want to say that I'm very mindful that it has been a tough year, and all of you who have had to deal with school closings and remote learning and all of that, I commend you for hanging in, and I thank you for all that you do. And it might seem like, you know, something more than you're willing to deal with. I'm so happy that so many people have signed on to this, because as we look to recover from COVID learning loss and all of the effects of that, once again, I think we will be, all of us, presented with the challenge of teaching reading, especially to kids who may have lost ground over the last year, who may not have had a chance to keep on practicing building their early reading skills or building their language comprehension in order to handle more complex texts and these things that we want them to do. So I'm very glad you're with me today, and I'm very glad that you're ready to dig in and really think more about how best to teach reading. So, here we go. What we're going to do is address these questions, albeit briefly. What is the science of reading? Why is there a chasm between science and educational practice? What are some of the bedrock findings from research that we all ought to keep in mind all the time, because we can hang our hats on those findings? What changes are needed to prepare teachers well, to prepare teachers better? And what does structured literacy look like? And can I give you a brief portrait of what to envision in the future? So what's the science of reading? When I use that term, I have a mental image, if you will, a schema of this map that Reed Lyon put together when he was running the NICHD reading research program in the 1990s and through about 2001. And what it conveyed, and it was just so helpful to see the number of centers across the country that had been funded with NIH grants to do both basic and applied research on reading. And all of these universities, and now the names are somewhat dated at this point, but At the time that I was involved as a co-principal investigator with Barbara Forman in Washington, D.C., and connected with University of Texas and University of Houston, all of these other centers were also actively pursuing a research agenda that had been designed by the NICHD. And so that's why they talked about a research program. It's not just a bunch of individual grants that these university centers have been working on, some of them for decades, but it's a program of research whereby certain questions are posed to the research community by an entity like the NICHD or the National Science Foundation or the Institute of Education Sciences. And people apply for grants to address these questions. And these studies are eventually published in scientific journals. And while they're going on, they are rigorously reviewed by research, independent researchers who are qualified to give feedback and evaluate whether the study is going the way it's supposed to go. And I, you know, when I was a teacher for a while, and when I got into this as a co-PI with Barbara Forman in Washington, D.C. and Houston, I really had no idea how it worked. And I feel so privileged that as an educator, I had, you know, an inside view of how this process works. And because we went through these rigorous independent reviews and we had to have all of our data scrutinized when we published papers and so on, it means a lot to me when I see an article published in a research journal that has a rigorous peer review process. And when I see a convergence of research over time and an acceptance of certain ideas and findings as, you know, having been validated over and over again, I'm very confident that we have a research base to inform a lot of what we do. Of course, there are limitations and there are continuing questions that are investigated on an ongoing basis. By centers like these. Nevertheless, if you've looked at the latest review of what we know from research by Petcher et al. From the Florida Center researchers that was published in Reading Research Quarterly, that is a very good summary of where we are, both what we really know that's been well validated and what we have yet to learn. So these were some of the key figures who were involved in that research initiative. Some of them are no longer with us, but we had that's Reed, that's Frank Villatino, that's Dave Francis looking quite young, that's Sharon Vaughn, that's Sally Shaywitz, that's Pat Lindemood, who has now passed away. Joe Torgerson is back there. I'm back there hiding because I feel as if I'm an interloper without anywhere near the credentials that many of these other individuals presented. And I think that I was invited to this initial meeting in which, the research agenda was formed up because I had worked with Reed in Vermont, and also I was more closely tied to the practitioner community than some others, and because I had a particular interest in language and in teaching teachers about language. So anyway, I'm lucky, but I just wanted you to know a little bit about where I come from and what shapes my thinking. So because I met all these great people, I was able to stay in touch with them over the decades where I actually had an active role in the research community, but then later as I took on the role of translating research through the letters professional development program mainly and the other things I've written, I have tried to capitalize on being privileged to be connected with this network of incredible people. So if you want to really look at the scholarship, these are some highly recommended textbooks. Of course, Seidenberg, another one called The Psychology of Reading. Keith Rayner is the lead author. And then the Fletcher, Lyon, Fuchs, and Barnes book in its second edition. And these are wonderful, wonderful syntheses of multiple studies from multiple disciplines about what we know about reading. I remember way back, even in 2000, when Keith Stanovich said that without question, reading was the most studied cognitive activity that humans engage in. But yet, okay, that we still are working on trying to bridge this chasm between reading scientists and reading educators. So what has caused the chasm? I like to reflect on this frequently because I'm asked about it frequently. And there are a lot of things at play here. These are two different worlds. The scientists are rewarded for scholarship and publishing in journals that are not read typically by educators. It's kind of an in-group. They're talking to each other. Some of what they do is quite inaccessible, difficult to translate. And on the practitioner side, there's often skepticism about the relevance of what some of this research is for classroom instruction, and skepticism about whether the researchers understand what the practitioners are up against. And a lot of us, and I was included in this, never had the training, unless we had doctoral training, to understand what in the heck they're talking about in some of these publications. So let's remind ourselves, why are we all concerned, practitioners and scientists? It's because we have too many kids who can't read and who experiences the consequence of that. And it doesn't really matter which set of data you look at. So if you want to talk about dyslexic kids and the population served by intensive intervention, that might be as many as 12% or 15%. If you want to talk about NAEP scores, we still have 34% of kids reading below basic in fourth grade. And the last time around, we had one state, which is Mississippi, showing significant improvement and some others falling back. And overall, no national improvement. That was 2019. And then if we look at the population of kids who are affected by poverty and a population that is way over overpopulated by kids of color, of course, we know this, and there's a big overlap there, the failure rate, unless we do something about it, is up to about 70%, 70 to 80%. And that's certainly what I walked into when I started working in the high poverty, low performing schools in Washington, which were almost all African-American high poverty kids in schools that were really hurting. So, and Julie Washington, of course, has really good data showing about the relationship between poverty, race, and schooling and the quality of schooling, if you want to consult her work. But one thing that is true no matter where you are, and from here I'm going to emphasize what all kids have in common, no matter what population they're a part of or where they go to school. Okay, so one thing we know is that reading trajectories are established very early. And this is one of the bedrock findings from the early research on early identification that led to the adoption of RTI, MTSS, policies in federal law, because we had so much evidence that if we didn't do something about incipient signs of being at risk in preschool, kindergarten, and first grade, that the kids were going to have a very high likelihood of being behind. If they started out at the 20th percentile at the beginning of first grade, they had something like a 90% chance of being at the 20th percentile or below as time went on. So this early research, a lot of it coming out of the University of Oregon in the 1990s, and then it's been carried on by many investigators, it convinced all of us that waiting around for kids to show us that they were behind at the end of first grade or second grade was a really losing proposition for everybody. And we coupled that with all the evidence that if we intervened really early, we could change the trajectory of growth for a lot of these kids who are at risk and get them on a path of normal growth in reading. But the earlier we did that, the better for everyone. Now, let's be clear about where this statement about 95% of the kids can be taught to read, where does that come from? And let me be very clear, because I think maybe what I've said in other presentations has not been as clear as it needs to be. In a number of papers that were written by Denton and Mathis, by Fletcher, Lyon, Fuchs, and Barnes in their first edition, by Torgerson in several papers, 2002 to 2004, and others, what the researchers did was look at the intervention studies that had been done up to that point, and also including, let's include Mathis and Denton, and their work a little bit later. If you took all the first graders who had been selected for their studies, and they and the researchers looked at the number of those at-risk kids who succeeded in learning to read, that is, their scores came up above the 25th percentile after intervention. And then the population of the school as a whole would be considered in terms of the risk factor for all the kids. The extrapolation or the population estimate of the first graders who would remain in the lower quartile after intervention was about 5% or fewer. So that's where the 95% figure comes from. And it means that if you intervene early and do the right stuff intensively enough, that you should have approximately 5% or fewer kids at the end of first grade who are really, you know, not making progress in basic reading skills. But what this does not say, and this is very important, it does not account for reading problems that may then emerge as text reading becomes more challenging, so that language, as time goes on, language comprehension, that part of the simple view of reading, will place more and more of a limit on the reading skills of kids, unless that aspect of foundational language ability is also addressed as kids learn to read. So I'll say more about that. But here is this classic study that Joe Torgerson did with Ray King, a principal in Hartsfield Elementary in Florida. And this is summarized and published in a paper by Torgerson in the Journal of School Psychology in 2002. But I love this graph that he put together because it's inspiring for all of us, especially people who work in Title I schools. Okay, so at the beginning of the study, the principal went to Joe Torgerson and said, I'm unhappy. I have 31.8% of my first graders who are in the lower quartile in reading at the end of first grade. And this just isn't good enough. So what can we do? So after the first year of this study, where the school adopted a core reading program that had all the right stuff in it. And I will tell you that it was the open court reading program that was in use at the time. It had a very strong design for teaching phoneme awareness, phonics in a systematic, explicit way, tied to text reading and reading fluency. After they did that for 1 year, the rate of reading failure, let's say below the 25th percentile in this study, the rate of reading failure went down to 20.4% just in a year of changing classroom instruction. And then a good screener based on Dibbles, an experimental version of Dibbles, was adopted in the second year. And then what happened? The teachers learned how to individualize and group kids according to their instructional needs and design intervention that was really aligned to the core program in the classrooms. And yet it was more intensive, more in terms of time and in terms of the number of kids in a group and the amount of practice kids were getting. And then after that, the school staff really became expert at using these tools of well-designed assessments, well-designed interventions, coordinated with regular classroom instruction and implementation of that, so that at the end of 5 years, the incidence of, if you want to call it reading failure at the end of first grade, was 3.7%. So this is, you know, I like this because it's not a research study per se. This was a real life on the ground school-based study with regular teachers in the system and a population of kids. I think 70%, if I recall correctly, were eligible for free and reduced lunch. This was not a privileged setting at all. And many of these were, this being Florida, were kids who were not highly proficient in English. So I think this is inspiring and it tells us what is possible to do if we do what is being suggested and we do it well. Okay, so now, is special ed the answer? And so what if we just take the kids who are at risk and assign them to special ed and say, well, a classroom teacher doesn't really have to deal with this. Well, one alarming statistic that came again out of the FCRR group was this study by Quinn and Wagner in 2015 in this huge database that they have, where they had, you know, across the state given these measures of oral reading fluency, nonsense word fluency, and vocabulary. And they found that one out of four boys and one out of seven girls who were seriously impaired in reading had ever been identified for special ed. And I think this is very striking. The message is that there are lots of kids out there in our schools who do not necessarily get flagged for special ed, who are very poor readers and whose needs may not be met just by having special ed assigned to make the difference for those kids. So how do we bring about wholesale change so that we can, you know, as a nation, replicate what King and Torgerson did those 20 some years ago? Well, one of the key factors in the big picture that I personally have been working on for a long time is the adequacy and inadequacy of teacher preparation. And I've been sort of singing this song, harping on this issue of inadequate teacher preparation a long time. And the last, the last major paper I wrote about it was for Learning Difficulties Australia, the Australian journal that published a paper in 2014 saying all the same thing. Many of my more qualified colleagues have also produced evidence about teacher knowledge and the relationship between teacher knowledge, teacher practice, and student outcomes. And I think we have a pretty solid body of evidence at this point showing several things. One is that most teachers are not privileged enough to learn about the structure of the English language in their preparation, even though when we teach reading and spelling, or we talk about teaching a structured language approach, the heart of it has to be comfort with and mastery of language as a content area for those of us who are teaching it explicitly. You can't explain something well to kids that you yourself don't understand. It would be like asking someone to teach math who, you know, couldn't do the basic operations or explain to somebody else how they're done. But we're asking teachers to do that all the time without giving them the foundational knowledge necessary. So I worked on the knowledge and practice standards for the IDA in 2010, and then the revision in 2018, where we laid out exactly what the knowledge base is that an expert teacher needs in order to be just well prepared to do the job, and also what the skills of practice, that what you do in the classroom are if you're going to implement an explicit systematic approach to teaching that structure of language. So I encourage anyone who has not seen the IDA standards and who wants to know specifically and in detail what we're talking about to have a good long look at those standards, because they're way more detailed than some of the other sets of standards that are out there. And also the IDA is building and has built an accreditation and certification process that is aligned to the standards that now is really beginning to have some influence. Now, as far as teacher prep goes, the work of the National Council on Teacher Quality has been important in documenting what is typically taught in our schools of ed. And their criteria were very rudimentary. Their criteria for reviewing the content of reading courses in teacher licensing programs. And this chart was from the latest review 2020, where they looked at a very simple thing, which is, are these so-called five pillars of reading instruction addressed in any adequate way in the course content in the licensing program or not? So yes or no, a kind of threshold. Is the stuff there in the course content or not? And the good news is that there was progress between 2013 and 2020 in terms of the reviewers recognizing that the content was addressed. But what is still so astonishing about this is that, well, we have phoneme awareness here, and they could find evidence that phoneme awareness was addressed adequately in only half of the courses of teachers at the elementary level. So the other half are getting out of school having no idea about this. And I'm about to tell you why that's really a problem. And then phonics, visible in less than 70% of the courses, fluency as an issue, about 50% of the courses, vocabulary as a content domain in reading instruction, less than 70%, and reading comprehension, less than 70%. So then you have to ask, as I ask, well, what in the world is in these courses? But that's a matter for another day. So let's look at a couple of other sources of evidence on how and why does teacher preparation need to improve? Well, one major study, the Binks-Cantrell et al. Study from SSR is remarkable because it showed that when the professors in the courses who were willing participants in the study were asked these questions, getting at some specifics in the knowledge base, this was the percent of success on the professor side. And this was the percent of success on those items of the students they were teaching. So just eyeballing this, even if you don't look at the items, you can see that there's no way that the students are demonstrating higher knowledge than the professors. So if the professors are, you know, have not treated a concept well because they themselves are unsure of it, then the students can't come away with the requisite knowledge. And so where do things begin to fall apart? Well, here, recognizing a word with two closed syllables, you know, the language of teaching orthographic structures in our spelling system, a definition of phonological awareness, 58% on the faculty, 47% on the part of the students. And this is really a problem. This is the year 2012, and the number of morphemes in these words, you know, this is not good. It means that morphology basically was at that time an untreated topic in teacher preparation. Naming the five components of the NRP, now you might argue and say, well, that's not important, except that it is important. If you have read the National Reading Panel, if you have looked at the umpteen papers and textbooks that have been that have referenced the National Reading Panel, the intervention programs that have chosen those five components as a way of organizing what they do and so on. So this just sort of hadn't penetrated in higher ed at that time. And then we have the Barksdale study, which was done in Mississippi prior to the major initiative in Mississippi that from the top down addressed all of the needs in the practicing teachers' need for professional development, faculty involvement, and so on. But they stated very clearly after reviewing what was taught in the schools of ed that established research-based principles of early literacy instruction remain largely unapplied in preparation and practice, and balanced literacy as interpreted by Mississippi teacher prep programs and many classrooms has resulted in, quote, widespread use of practices that are not supported by research. So it's, you know, it's one thing to say that the research itself hasn't penetrated. It's more concerning, I think, to document that many of the practices are not supported by research and therefore are ineffective and therefore are contributing to the statistics on reading failure. So this is my favorite cartoon. It says we have lots of information technology, we just don't have any information. And you know, there's just so much going on in the field of reading all the time. But yet, if we're going to do better, we have to sift through what is credible and what isn't, and really take a look at the difference between what we ought to be doing and what is often going on in our classrooms. So back to Mississippi, what has worked there? Well, it was a statewide initiative. And you know, every time I talk about this, I'm implying that it's possible with a unified state level approach from the top down and bottom up to make a huge difference in statewide results. So they adopted rigorous science of reading standards for teacher candidates, followed up by a test that's aligned with the rigorous standards. They adopted a third grade reading imperative now and have upped the ante, made the standard higher for kids coming out of third grade to demonstrate that they're good readers. After the course audit, they incentivized university faculty to join a consortium and redesign their teacher prep courses. And all that's ongoing. A colleague of mine is working with those faculty members now for the third year. They funded statewide professional development and coaching in the science of reading for all the teachers already in the classroom. And why is all this necessary? Like, why can't we just say, okay, you know, let's do it? Well, it's because, you know, it's back to the rocket science theme. The science of reading is not obvious or natural or intuitive for us to grasp. And here's some of the evidence. Anne Cunningham at Berkeley has done several studies of teachers and teacher knowledge and practice. So she asked the teachers how they would prefer to teach reading in her study. These were first grade teachers, and concluded that it, quote, "it appears that a philosophical orientation towards literature-based instruction tends to be more exclusive of other instructional approaches." In other words, if a teacher has embraced the sort of philosophy of literature-based instruction and whole language and the sort of hostility toward systematic code-based instruction that's embedded, implied there, then the teacher's also likely to be less responsive to that kind of professional development if it's offered. And then Anne Cunningham said the teacher's preferred practices do not conform to current research and policy recommendations for teaching first graders. And then Susan Brady did a major study with a federal grant with first grade teachers and also said that their philosophical framework about reading instruction was germane to the extent teachers learned the content of direct methods of reading instruction. In other words, those with a whole language orientation were less responsive to professional development in phonology, phonics, and spelling. You know, the nitty gritty word recognition part of learning to read that is rather technical and involves knowing a lot of specific things about phonemes and graphemes and syllables and morphemes and how the brain works to learn that aspect of reading. Well, then, if you're still skeptical about all this, you might say, well, so what? Isn't there evidence that teacher knowledge doesn't matter that much because there's so much to the art of teaching as well as the science that that teachers can get really good results because they're very good at sort of the engagement of students and the less quantifiable aspects of teaching that we're not asking about on these surveys. So I've tried to keep a record of studies that do show a relationship between what teachers know and what the students learn. So there is, and I would point to especially the work of Shane Piasta and her colleagues right now, who are continuing to document that teacher knowledge does affect student outcomes. And in a study that she did in 2009 on the implementation of classroom instruction, students' gains were predicted by the interaction between teacher knowledge and the amount of explicit decoding instruction that the students received. Highly scripted core curricula, quote, cannot replace the expert teaching of highly knowledgeable teachers. In other words, the answer here is not adopting a program and telling the teachers they have to implement it unless they have they've bought in because they understand the content and why it's important and for whom it's important. So in her study, more code instruction by teachers with low levels of knowledge didn't produce any student gains. So I like to say pejoratively, there are lots of ways to mess it up. If you don't understand how phonics works yourself, even if the manual right in front of you is telling you to teach a lesson a certain way, and you don't know that TH together represents the fricative th, and that's called a digraph. And if you, you know, teach kids to blend words, that you don't teach them th, you teach them th. And I saw that several times with my teachers before they learned what was what. It doesn't work. So there's no replacing the importance of what teachers know and the coaching and support they've received in the application of that knowledge. So what is it that we're talking about? What do teachers need to know? Well, first of all, scientifically sound models of how we learn to read. And that's very important because in our, you know, you go on the internet and start looking at a sort of graphic organizers about what it means to learn to read. Some of them come out of science and some of them somebody made up just on a whim. And there's a big difference there. We also need comprehensive roadmaps for teaching all essential components independent of programs. We need to know how the English language is structured at all levels. And I would say if you have a big group of English learners in your class and they tend to come from one language community, it's really helpful also to understand how their home language may be structured so that you can engage in some comparative analysis. That's asking a lot, but that's a high level of expertise. And then modeling and practice of structured literacy lessons, it's really important. We do find that even when teachers begin to understand the research and what it's saying, it's not easy to translate that into a series of procedures and activities and lesson frameworks and all the stuff that Anita Archer teaches us about explicit instruction. Okay, so the models that we're talking about, I hope this is in every a poster on everybody's wall at this point. Of course, Scarborough's Rope has gotten tremendous play over the last few years. It's 20 years old, but the thing that's so great about it is it came from Hollis Scarborough, an eminent scientist who knew very well the significance of each of these strands in accounting for the growth of reading over time and the attainment of skilled, fluent reading as a goal. So this model suggests that if we really know what we're doing, we're going to be thinking about how we address each of these components of language comprehension, even before kids learn to read, and we'll do it at an oral language level. And we're going to systematically address these three critical strands of word recognition in order to ensure that kids can read the words accurately and fluently after a certain amount of time. At every strand in this rope has to do with language. Something, again, that we don't think about enough sometimes. And what do I mean by that? Language is made up of subsystems that include the syntactic system of the language, organizational structures in discourse that have to do with how an informational text is organized, for example, how a narrative text is organized. We have a system of semantic relationships, both at the word level and at the sentence level. Morphology kind of stands between meaning making at the vocabulary level and word recognition, understanding of the writing system. Pragmatics is the system, the rule system for using language in social situations. The writing system, which is a representational system for language, and that's our orthography, and the phonological system for processing everything having to do with speech, not only the individual phonemes, but the contours of pronunciation of a multisyllabic word or a phrase or a sentence. So what are some key and counterintuitive research findings about how we learn to read words? Let's take the word recognition component of the rope. This is very important, and I think beginning to get the attention that it deserves. And that's that generic visual spatial skills are virtually unrelated to reading and spelling. So to the extent that we talk about errors as being visual, that's a total misnomer. And the term really should not be used. If you want to talk about them as orthographic, at least that's better. If kids are misreading words or misspelling words, talk about orthographic errors, because the term orthographic has the semantic connection to language. An orthography is a representation of language. It's not just an arbitrary visual symbol system. And error patterns, as it turns out, are eminently linguistic, and they often indicate weaknesses in skills that are dependent on phonology. Language proficiencies are the best predictors of both good and poor reading and spelling. So as they said at the Haskins Lab many years ago, reading and spelling are bootstrapped onto oral language. Word recognition does not depend on context or word shape. And rote visual memorization drills for reading and spelling are generally ineffective. And let me demonstrate this. This was a client of mine years ago when I was in private practice, and it struck me as exhibit A of this principle that generic visual spatial skills are unrelated pretty much to reading and spelling. And just think about it. Think about all the artists you've heard about who are very dyslexic and who can't spell. Think about all the people who are verbally proficient and who cannot do anything in the visual spatial domain. These things are dissociated. So my guy here, Danny, who is quite bright, but who grew up in a very low SES, we'll say, family in rural Vermont, without any privileges whatsoever, going to a rural school that had no art teacher at all, had taught himself how to draw. And I was very impressed by this because it has three dimensionality and it has shading and it has dynamic movement. It's amazing that he could just draw this to demonstrate what he had taught himself. And yet he can't spell the word ride, and he leaves sounds out of words like around. And he hasn't learned how to spell the word your, and also his reading scores were significantly below average, and he was struggling in everything having to do with reading and spelling. So when we see this in a classroom, we should be able to say, wait a minute, a very conscientious person drew an outline around this word, but it's not going to help a student learn how to read it. The shape around the configuration is not distinctive in any way. And the outside shape of a word has nothing to do with the way we code that word in memory. So let's let go of this in all its forms. We learn to read and spell this way. We learn that sh A and P go together to represent shape. Also, context, relying on context is what poor readers do because they are not good at decoding. So they'll fall back on extraneous cues that are not helpful. I think it was Phil Goff, I'm not positive, documented that as you get into normal text, context helps you predict a word accurately about one time in 10. So we want to let go of these kinds of cues and think instead about building in the word form area of the brain a mental image of a word that is constructed from its linguistic elements. When we look at a word like this, unreachable, and recognize it instantly, we do so because the brain has already formed associations to these parts that we call morphemes, meaningful parts, unreachable, prefix, base word, suffix. And in order to do that, we have parsed the word into its syllables, unreachable. And we have learned that these syllables are spelled by or represented phoneme by phoneme with a series of graphemes that in this case include a vowel team and a consonant digraph and a letter combination that stands for ul, which we call a syllabic consonant. And in order to do this, we have recognized all of the letters in the word. So in reverse, the way we achieve automatic word recognition for thousands of words is to build up our capacity to notice all of these aspects of words and to quickly map the speech to print relationship by noticing phoneme grapheme correspondences, syllable structures, familiar morphemes, and then those are the tools for forming an image in our memories that will be readily retrievable in an instant. I had an experience that I thought I would throw into this presentation of reading along and coming to this word. And at first I said to myself, read just. So I attached a pronunciation to it. That was the first thing I had to do. But I attached the wrong pronunciation to it. So let's pretend that my experience replicates that of someone who is still learning to read and who is encountering unknown words as they read. What do they have to do? They have to attach a pronunciation to those letters. And in doing that, I divided these two syllables here because there's a vowel here represented by this grapheme and a vowel here. So I could tell it was two familiar syllables and almost as if it were a compound. However, I had to say to myself, I don't recognize that. What do I know already in my meaning processor or my mental dictionary that might match this word? So then I had to tweak or adjust the pronunciation and try dividing the word a different way. So then I divided it in two places instead of one. And I said, oh, that could be readjust. Which is it? Do I know a word readjust? Or read just, which one do I know? And so this one is the one that registered with my mental dictionary. Now, of course, another implication of this little demonstration is that if you have students with weak vocabularies, who don't already have a word in their mental dictionaries, and they come across a word like this, they don't have the independent means of deciding whether the word is readjust or readjust and need to be taught gradually how to try the word a different way and to recognize the familiar prefix here that might help and to recognize that the word can be divided between these two consonants. So gradually they would build up that capacity. But I've been reading a book, Hoover and Tunmer's book on the cognitive foundations of reading. And they do a very nice treatment of how important it is to sort of coach kids through flexible use of decoding skills as they are acquiring them, because there'll be many instances where they have to take a reasonable guess at the pronunciation of a word and then tweak it by trying it a different way and trying to match the word, hopefully, to one that they have already heard and have in their mental dictionaries. Seidenberg's triangle model is the basis for this diagram that we have exploited, if you will, in letters in order to remind ourselves of how words are recognized. This is a model of word recognition, and there are two very important points to be made with this model. One is that learning phonics involves bolstering both the phonological system and awareness and attention to the orthographic system. In other words, it involves matching speech to print and print to speech, and it involves enhancing the student's ability to pay attention to the internal details of the spoken word and the internal details of the written word. And that is the basis for learning phonics. And as we just demonstrated, being able to connect phonics or phonic decoding to meaning is a big asset. But what is the role of context? The role of context is to help us decide what form, what meaning of a word is being used in a sentence. It is not to drive decoding. That's the most important message from this. So as we're teaching reading, what are we actually doing? We are enhancing the brain's ability to build pathways among and between these separate key anatomical regions of the brain that are not naturally connected at birth. And of course, Stanislaus Dehaene is the guru around illustrating how the reading brain develops. Highly recommend looking up his talks, if you will. But in order to populate this visual word form area with memories of words, we have to build pathways to the phonological system from here to here and back and forth, and then connect to meaning here. And of course, we have lots of brain studies now that show the reading brain or the brain learning to read. And these are from the University of Texas at Houston, slides that were provided to me by Jack Fletcher. And this is the left hemisphere of the brain. This is a low risk student. In other words, one who is building these pathways with a lot of activity here. The student's a good decoder. This is a high-risk responder to intervention, one who is responding to instruction in phoneme, grapheme correspondences and who is learning to activate this critical midpoint between phonology and orthographic learning. And this is a high-risk non-responder, a student who is having a lot of trouble connecting the word form area with the phonological area. And you can see there's no activity happening there. Excuse me. So let's talk about intervention. And if you have Anita Archer working with you all, you have the best. And if you look back over what all of the successful intervention studies have had in common, they all are systematic, explicit. That means the teacher is leading the students and not just waiting for the students to figure things out. There's a scope and sequence for cumulative instruction, judicious review. There is multimodal engagement. The instruction is intensive, meaning lots of practice opportunities and day-to-day if we can do it. And the focus is on the structure of the language. Knowing it when you see it, there will be a scope and sequence for foundational skills, a phonic scope and sequence, a phoneme awareness hierarchy. There will be a clear way of identifying what is a phoneme awareness activity and what is a phonics and spelling activity. Now, in my opinion, these should be closely linked, but they are not exactly the same. Phoneme awareness has to do with tuning in the ear and the brain to speech itself. And then once that identity of the phoneme is established, we can pair the phoneme with its grapheme or graphemes. Students are systematically taught to decode sounds, syllables, and morphemes in word recognition. I know there's an article, there are not only articles, but arguments about how much work on syllabification to do. I would say some of it. Let's leave it there for now. Decodable text is used for practice of what has been taught. So now if you see a program that's basically a literature-based approach, and they say they're going to now adopt some decodable text, well, that's not really the point. The point of decodable text is to practice what was taught in the rest of the systematic explicit lesson on how the code works. And then within the total language arts block, half the instructional time, approximately, give or take, depending on the students, half the instructional time is devoted to building language comprehension through read alouds and other activities until the kids can read text that has some meaning to it. I think it is helpful to lay out for teachers and for students what is in the code. And one of the ways that we do it is to take all of the vowels of English, E, I, A, E, A, I, A, 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 O, O, U, and glided U, schwa, the diphthongs oi and au, and three are controlled, are, and or, and then gradually show the students the way we spell each of these major vowel sounds in English. This chart is organized by the articulatory properties of the vowels. So these vowels here are the high smiley vowels, E, I. These vowels are close in articulation. These are close in articulation. So each vowel that's one step away from the next could potentially be confused with one that's next to it. The base layer for word recognition is phoneme-grapheme correspondences. And one of the ways that we demonstrate this is to use a grid, or you can also use just lines, or you can use slashes. But the point of the exercise is to show which graphemes represent the phonemes in the spoken word. In this case, each box stands for a phoneme. So if we have a word with a consonant blend like drive, that blend needs two boxes because each of the consonants is articulated in the word, d, r, I know we co-articulate when we say drive, but that is not one sound in the beginning. Dive is different from drive because there's an er in there. If we have a consonant digraph, we put it in one box because it stands for one sound, and so on. And if we have a complex formation like the silent E long vowel rule, we do something with that E other than put it in a box because it doesn't represent a sound, but it does have a function as a marker of that long vowel. So we might illustrate it that way. So a few words on the language comprehension side of things, and then I'll be wrapping this up in a few minutes so that we can engage in more of a dialogue. Perfetti's notion of deep lexical quality and the necessity and desirability of establishing in our mental dictionaries a deep and elaborated concept of a word is a very important thing for us as teachers. Because if we realize that we learn words and the network of associations around each individual word very gradually over time through multiple exposures, and we gradually learn lots about a word as we deepen our knowledge of it, we learn its connotations and its denotations and its multiple meanings. And we learn where to use it, and we learn its synonyms and its antonyms. And we also learn the relationship between its spelling and its pronunciation and all of these meaning-based dimensions of the word. Then when we're teaching, we can think, oh, how am I going to approach this vocabulary lesson today? I can focus on antonyms. I can focus on semantic overlap and synonyms. I can focus on multiple meanings of the same word and how context determines the meaning of the word. I can look at the morphology of the word and the spelling and how that connects to the meaning of the word. I can talk about word origin. So I like to think of this as this diagram and this idea is affording us many ways to look at a word. Excuse me. Okay, so in introducing a new vocabulary word, a lot of this, of course, we've learned from Isabel Beck and others. We need a routine for those words you think are most essential for students to comprehend a passage. And the routine goes something like this. You pronounce and read the word. You look at the spelling, because that's often helpful. Tell the students what the new word means using a student-friendly definition. Say more about that word. Use it several times. Ask questions about the word's meaning, and then elicit word use by the students. Because until the students have used the word, they don't really own it. So an example here, suppose I want students, maybe this is a third grade class, pronounce and read the word flexible. Let's look at the spelling, flexible, a root and a suffix. The root means to bend, flex. Ible is an adjective suffix. It makes it into an adjective. We tell students what the new word means using a student-friendly definition, like flexible material can bend easily without breaking. And we can say more about it, give more context. The best gymnasts are very flexible. They can bend way over or do the splits. Now we start asking questions. Is hair flexible or rigid? Yes or no? Is a nail flexible or rigid? Yes or no? And then we set the students up to produce the word. A healthy ankle can roll all around if it is what? My schedule can be adjusted. I am what? Paperback books bend in your hands. They are what? And then you might say, okay, would someone like to give me a sentence? But you don't start with, who can give me a sentence? You want all the students to get to the point where they can give you a sentence. And then if the word does have morphological construction, you can show students that there's a whole family of words that are related, maybe read through those words to show how often that root flex is going to show up in other vocabulary. So here I need to stop so we have a chance to talk, but back to the reading rope and all that it suggests on the language comprehension domain of what we need to do as we're engaging in text reading and writing with kids. There are aspects of language, especially the formal academic language that we use in school, that should be dealt with in an explicit way. And the reason I'm talking about this is that there's been so much discussion about the importance of background knowledge. That's a really hot topic now. Well, just build the background knowledge and that accounts for everything in reading comprehension. I heard an expert say that the other day, and I just think that's an overstatement, because I would combine that with a lot of opportunities for kids to learn how to manage the language, to navigate the language in a text. And that includes special uses of words in context, figurative language, multiple meanings, academic language formalities that you don't find in conversation, discourse structure, how it works, phrase structure and sentences, topic-specific terminology. And then syntax. Okay, suppose the sentences, the rigid metal bar was replaced by a more flexible one. Well, what was replaced by what? Who did the what did the replacing? This passive voice can be a problem for kids. Or we had no reason to think she was less flexible than her competitor. That's a double negative. That's not easy to process. lack of flexibility is a major problem versus lack of flexibility is the major problem. Little words matter. Those articles matter. The firm footbed was adequate, although it would have been better constructed with more flexible material. It would have been better constructed. You will have a lot of kids who have never used a verb construction like that in their own speech and who need help paying attention to what those helping verbs convey and what the tense is, what the meaning is. So we could talk a lot more about building the mental model. Maybe that's a talk for another time, but that is definitely the goal. And maybe we leave it there. Okay. The IDA Knowledge and Practice Standards, a good resource. And I will leave you with Anna Quinlan's wonderful statement here. Books are the means to immortality. Through them all, we experience other times, other places, other lives. We manage to become much more than our own selves. And we want that for all of our students. Thank you so much, everyone.
Well, thank you so much, Dr. Moats. We do have some questions, so I really appreciate you leaving some time for questions. So our colleague, Alicia Roberts-Frank, you know, said, gosh, you know, can you help me explain how to teach words that have the ear sound, like hear and fear? How would you best teach kids how to understand that?
Okay, those words are very difficult. Some of the most unpredictable spellings in basic orthography are those for ear, for or. So those long vowels followed by R. So how do you do it? My advice is to take one construction at a time, practice a set of words, because here's something I neglected to say that I think I don't emphasize enough. And now I'm thinking of what I've learned from David Scher, the Israeli psychologist who has written so much about the so-called self-teaching hypothesis. His point is this: as much as we help kids learn how the code works, and we should do that. What we are actually doing is giving them the mental mechanics or the mental architecture for learning individual words. There's no way around the fact that hear, H-E-A-R and H-E-R-E, have to be learned as individual words that are associated with particular meanings. So knowing the sound structure is only one aspect of what has to be learned. So then, you know, if I was thinking about it as a instructional problem, I would think about this. I would think one pattern at a time, make sure that the kids are processing all of the details of the print, and then really work on the use of the important vocabulary in context so that kids then also have the cognitive handle of the meaning of the word, the spelling of the word, and the sound of the word. Back to Seidenberg's triangle model, you know, to really know a word well, you have to form a mental image that has the sound, the spelling, and the meaning all connected. So it is very difficult for kids who just, you know, don't remember easily or well. And the worse the problem is, the more you have to concentrate on the most important vocabulary for them to know. One of the things I've seen with dyslexic kids or kids who are poor spellers especially is that the more they learn about how the code works, the more tools they have for deciding when they're using spell checker, which one may work, or they use crib sheets and other things to jog their memories. But we don't have a perfect solution for that.
Thank you, Dr. Moats. So a similar question is from our colleague, Megan. My students struggle with the R sound. They interchange IR, ER, UR, because each make the same sound. What is a good way to teach that? This is similar to the question that was just asked.
Yeah, it is. Well, ER is most common as a representation for R, especially because it's used as a suffix so often, right? And IR, I think, is more common in single syllable words. I have to look this up. This is off the top of my head. UR is a less common spelling. But again, what I would do is remember that spelling those words is much harder than reading them. You can read turn, T-U-R-N, without necessarily remembering that's how it's spelled. So I would, again, you picked on the hardest things for kids to learn here. Do a few at a time, one construction at a time. So for example, what I would not do is throw all of those spellings for R into one spelling lesson. No, I would not do that. And I would start with ER. And I would add in IR for the most important words. Most kids are used to seeing the word girl. And one thing to explain to get them to pay attention to it is that your mouth is saying er. You don't hear a vowel when you say the word. And er is a totally unitized vowel. You know, there's not a vowel plus R. It is just er. And then you just go step by step and work on the most important ones for kids to remember and then gradually add in. I think word sorting can be helpful to teach the basic concept, but remembering which is which, it's hard. You know, and just think learning theory, okay? They didn't remember. I have to do less. I have to practice more. I have to give more practice in context. I have to revisit those words next week, even though, you know, I wish they had learned them this week.
Now on to schwa. So how do you suggest teaching schwa? It is almost a separate syllable type, and it appears in so many multi-syllabic words.
Yes, it does. And very good. So the first thing is to teach kids that it exists. And I would start with two syllable words. I think that Michael Hunter and Linda Farrell have, I think they've recorded a lesson on teaching schwa that's posted in Reading Rockets. And what they do is take simple two syllable words. Let's start with wagon. All right. And they put wag on up on a, you know, the magnetic letters, and they say, okay, what are these two parts, kids? And they say wag on, and they say, what if I put this together? What does it say? Kids say wagon. Okay, what happened to the second syllable? You swallowed that vowel. You made it into an indistinct vowel that had the stuffing taken out of it. That's called schwa. And then they show them a little symbol for schwa. Then the next step is going through a list of other two syllable words that have a clear schwa in them, like circus, second syllable. And then where the first syllable is a schwa, like adjust. And mark where the schwa is. So the first thing is making kids aware of when it exists. And then in teaching spelling, for us as teachers, what we have to remember is that kids cannot rely on pronunciation to recover the vowel identity in a syllable where the pronunciation is a schwa. So we have to appeal to other things like morphology and sometimes an artificial spelling pronunciation. The classic one is Wednesday. For Wednesday, or other words that where the spelling does not, where you can't recover the spelling from the pronunciation. So those are all the tricks I have.
Okay, now moving on to dyslexia. A colleague of ours says, I have a fellow educator friend who says that dyslexia is not a thing. I believe it is a thing. Do you believe that it is a thing? And if so, how would you define dyslexia?
It's not a matter of belief, please. You know, and if someone says that, I don't even respond with a belief statement. I just say, okay, I have a big bookshelf back there. there is, okay, first of all, there's a difference between someone who says it doesn't exist, and we still have those people in the world, and someone who says, I don't like this word. I want to call it a word level reading disability. Okay, that is a superficial debate. And then as far as the word itself, I say, I like the word, but for me, it's a descriptor. It describes unusual, unexpected difficulty learning to read words in the presence of adequate instruction and preparation and adequate intellectual ability. Does this exist? Well, I mean, I think I would just go to the all the pictures of the brains of kids who can't learn to read that are posted on the University of Houston and University of Texas at Houston websites. They've published umpteen studies about the differences in the response of the brain to stimulation around learning to read, and how much more difficult it is for kids who are dyslexic to build those pathways. And also all of the evidence, which is undeniable, that there is this specific linguistic capacity called phonological processing that has been demonstrated through a number of different disciplines, not just neuroscience, but many other disciplines, to be at the root of almost all of these problems that kids can have with word level reading difficulty. Now, you can argue about what's the incidence. Is it 20%? Is it 2%? Is it something in between? And you resolve those arguments by saying, well, let's look at the research and how the samples are identified. That's why I use the term as a descriptor, because for me, it's perfectly appropriate to say, so-and-so has some mild symptoms of dyslexia, or they're a bit dyslexic. To me, that's perfectly appropriate. That's not the same thing as saying that they qualify for special education as a student with a handicapping condition, because it may not be equivalent to a handicapping condition. And that involves a separate set of criteria that have to be applied by the school system for eligibility for special ed. To me, that's a whole other thing. I think the term is very helpful in conveying that the problem is difficulty with language. It is not a visual handicap. It does not have to do with reversals. It does not have to do with confusing left and right. It does not have to do with general intellectual impairment. I mean, there are all kinds of reasons for using the term. At the same time, we shouldn't be making unwarranted claims about diagnosis and treatment just because we've used the word. What else can I say? We have to this person who says it doesn't exist. Well, then I'd say, okay, we also know through twin studies they've been going on at the University of Colorado for a long time, that when there's a family history of reading disability, that the children in that family have at least a 50% chance of also having the reading disability. So that speaks to something that happens in brain development that is wired into a person's genes that affects how readily they respond to instruction in learning how to read. So, you know, it's not all an environmental problem. It's a complex interaction between environment and genes and biology. So that's true for a whole lot of developmental disabilities.
Thank you, Dr. Moats. I think we're at 3 minutes, so I think this is all we have time for is one more question. So a colleague of ours asked, many schools in the state of Michigan are currently using balanced literacy. Can you speak to what you've seen from data as schools transition to a structured literacy approach? What are some recommendations that you might have to districts who see this as an overwhelming endeavor, but really do want to use structured language and literacy?
Okay, great. Well, we do need to make that transition. And yet it is hard. So what I recommend is, first of all, don't try to do it overnight. Have about a 3-year plan. What I would start with is professional development, where you're not asking teachers to make a wholesale change in what they do, but you're teaching them about these conceptual theoretically grounded models of what it means to learn to read, why it's so important to really do the foundational skills systematically and skillfully, how to use assessments so that instruction can be differentiated. And one thing I would say that might ease some of the pain around that is that if you have a certain population of kids who have learned to read sort of in spite of the way you've been teaching, and that's one of the things that's keeping it going, right, is that some kids piece it together kind of no matter how they're taught. And Jean Chalo used to talk about this. A third of the kids are going to learn with some kind of, you know, exposure and books and pointing at the words, and they figure out spot is spot. You know, when you say see spot run, they figure it out. And so you may want to start by using a good assessment to flag those kids who are at risk right in the beginning of the process and starting to change what you do with them. And then when you see, but the problem there is that then the interventions are not going to be aligned with the regular classroom instruction. And it's very self-defeating to have a student in an intervention program that is really trying to get the student to do the hard work of decoding and then have them go back to class and have the teacher say, now just take a peek at the picture and take a good guess at what that word might be. And there are no decodable readers there for them to practice. So, you know, that's not an ideal situation. But, you know, I think you have to start by getting everybody on board with a set of concepts and maybe starting to use some of the right kinds of assessments to see where their kids really are in these critical underlying skills. And then what a lot of districts are doing is a kind of add on, well, now we'll add on a systematic phonics piece and we'll add on a phonemic awareness piece. That's not ideal. The better thing to do is to just say, okay, we're going to make a shift here and we're going to have a coherent, integrated core program that has the pieces and that are all aligned with each other, instead of having a book for this and a book for that and a book for that, and they don't line up. I don't know. I see schools going about it a lot of different ways, but.
Thank you, Dr. Moats. And I apologize. We're supposed to go till 5:30. So clearly I could not tell time. So that is my.
Well, I thought we had more time, so.
We did. Right. I just did not look accurately at my clock. I've been so in tune to the questions. Okay, another question. MTSS and the science of reading almost seem like they are two separate things. How do you see them needing to work together to effectively support both educators and students?
Well, I think of MTSS as a service delivery framework, and it doesn't say much about the content of what is taught. And MTSS for me means basically instruction is differentiated based on data. So what's critical is that you're measuring the right things at the right times often enough to monitor student progress. Another tenet is that whatever small groups you form for instruction are flexible so that a reevaluation takes place every 10 weeks or so and students are moved in and out of groups. And also that there's a relationship between whole group instruction in the classroom and then smaller group interventions of various intensity and a very varying content, depending on what the kids need. When we talk about that, what gets neglected sometimes is, well, then how do we best teach each of these kids or in each of these settings? So that's where a structured language approach has to be implemented with the teachers understanding the content of explicit language instruction. And that means knowing what the phonemes are, knowing how the graphemes represent them, knowing how the syllables work, knowing what the morphemes are, knowing how the language of origin of a word might affect how it's spelled, and then being comfortable teaching explicit sound blending, phoneme grapheme mapping, various kinds of practice exercises, and the use of decodable text reading, and then spelling and dictation. Those things are in a good code-based lesson. And there are, you know, not that many great integrated comprehensive programs that you can put your hand on that, you know, I have a pretty short list. I better not say it in a meeting like this, but and then, so, you know, that the content and its importance on how to teach it is first in my view, because then if the regular classroom teacher is teaching all these essential pieces really well, then the number of kids who are going to be flagged as below benchmark on a good, Dibbles or Cadence or AIMS-Web screener is going to be fewer and fewer. And those kids are going to have more and more intensive needs.
So Dr. Moats, there are a variety of questions about intervention strategies. So there are a couple I wanted to highlight. What are some of your feelings about the effectiveness of using colored transparencies to help colored overlays on words to help students read?
Well, my feelings are that we should look at the evidence, and the evidence is very clear that that's a waste of time. That now, as far as teaching reading goes, now there may be such a thing, this is independent of reading, there may be such a thing as an unusual sensitivity to a certain, in light frequencies, that means that the person, is irritated by certain brightness or certain colors. But this is not a widespread phenomenon. And you can find really good write-ups about how this has been researched. Both on the IDA's website there have been, for those of you who are members, there have been articles published by IDA over the last few decades on questionable therapies or unproven therapies, and colored lenses have been written about several times. There is also a statement by the American Ophthalmological Association on teaching reading that says very directly that a lot of what optometrists do in the name of eye exercises that are supposed to treat reading problems also have no evidence to support them. And these are pretty authoritative sources, so I recommend going to those.
Okay, so we have a variety of questions about interventions, and I know you don't necessarily want to give a list of interventions that you would recommend. Can you talk about some features again of interventions that schools may want to look at for middle school students, so secondary students, versus students in the elementary grades?
Okay, well, in middle school, I have a conflict of interest because I'm an author of a middle school intervention program. So, and I think it's pretty good, and I don't want to recommend anybody else's.
That's fair.
But I'll just say that, I'll say this, that for middle school, the same principles in addressing a reading problem are important, and that is that the large majority of middle school poor readers also have word recognition problems. So a strong component of an effective middle school intervention is going to be basic instruction in phonics and syllabification and morphology, word recognition. And at the same time, all the text reading skills have to be nurtured. And if kids are really poor readers, the text reading will be highly scaffolded and or done through oral reading with the kids following along. But the subject matter needs to be age appropriate. The topics have to be age appropriate and stimulating for kids to be talking about, responding to, and wanting to write about and talk about. So what was the other part of the question for other kids?
Features of elementary, highly effective elementary intervention programs versus secondary. So you gave some features at the secondary level.
Yeah, and then for, early elementary, that have been researched or the principles of instruction that come from research are that you have to have very strong coordinated strands. Think of the reading rope of phoneme awareness. Now, what do we really mean by that? We don't just mean that the student can take the sounds apart in a one-syllable word. What I mean by it is that the student has been taught the identity of the sounds. Let me give you an example. Okay, I showed the vowel chart with the vowels by articulation, and a classic problem in early reading instruction is getting kids to respond with the correct short vowel when they read a one-syllable word. And usually what happens is the kids confuse I and eh, and they confuse ah and uh. And why do they do that? Because those vowels are very close in articulation, so they don't have the advantage of a clear articulatory feedback loop to help them remember the sound that goes with a letter. That's one of the problems. That's the phonological base of the problem, is, you know, poorly established internal sense of what in the heck those sounds are anyway. And it doesn't help if you're from a region of the country where fill and fell are basically pronounced the same, or pin and pen, right? It's even more of a problem. Up there in the north, I don't think you have that problem. But if you're thinking this way of helping the kids form a clear mental image of each of the sounds, even the ones that are close in articulation, then you use things like feel what your mouth is doing, look in a mirror. With I and eh, you know, with I, your teeth are almost closed. With eh, your mouth is slightly open and you can get your fingertip in there. And I look at the difference. And then you give a clue like itch for I and eh, edge for eh or ed or echo. You have a gesture, you have a picture. But the key thing is that the student associates the actual physical production of the sound with the letter. And sometimes we don't pay any attention to that. We just, you know, drill on the letters and what they're supposed to remember, when the anchor point for what, you know, what that letter represents isn't clearly enough established in the phonological processing system. So that's going to be much more of an issue with the kids who are in intervention. And also, you may, especially in the early grades, the kids who aren't getting the code need a lot of back and forth between spoken language and written language, so that everything they read, they need to pronounce. And if you're pronouncing something, they need to say it also. You need to check how they're pronouncing a word that they're trying to spell. When they're reading a word, you need to make sure that they can say it, and then also hopefully attach it to meaning. So, you know, building up that association between identification of the sounds, identification of the graphemes and letter arrays, and then connection to meaning is much more of a step-by-step incremental process for kids who need intervention in most cases. You cannot teach haphazardly. You cannot throw things at kids. It has to be very planful.
That dovetails into our next two questions, both of which are related to special educators. So the first one is, does it make sense that special educators are empowered with training in the science of reading, structure, language, and literacy?
Yes.
We're going to say that.
I mean, how could they not? Their caseload is going to be 80% kids who can't read.
Absolutely.
And it's crazy. We find in those surveys that the NCTQ did on teacher prep, the special ed teachers get even less training in teaching reading than some of the elementary ed teachers. Now, how did that ever happen? It's nuts.
Absolutely. So piggybacking off of that, is it appropriate for special education to support students with reading disabilities in phonics past third grade?
Yes. It depends on what your diagnostic data are telling you. If the student has not acquired accurate, efficient word recognition, it needs to continue. And one of the best ways to do that actually is to put more emphasis on spelling and writing. Because if you can spell a word or you've studied the spelling of a word, the chances are that the inverses of reading the word will be strengthened. But yeah, I mean, the answer to that, I don't care if you have an adult who's a poor reader, you need to do a survey of their knowledge of phonics and their word recognition skills. And if they don't have them, there's no way you can expect someone to, you know, make substantial growth in text reading if they can't read the words. This is the most fundamental idea that comes out of reading science.
We always appreciate your candor, Dr. Moats. So one question.
It doesn't pay to be anything less than straightforward.
We appreciate that. So this is a question about the role of curriculum publishers. And this question is centering around some of the frustrations when curriculum companies drive PDs, drive professional learning and drive their resources around misaligned instructional methods that have been repackaged and are now, the label is slapped on that they're aligned with reading science. What suggestions do you have for educators and leaders in being able to be good consumers and carefully reviewing and selecting things that are truly aligned with science?
Well, it's really imperative that we do this because the charlatans are hard at work and they are, you know, taking the same old stuff and putting a different label on it or doing a little Band-Aid here and there or doing a really poorly written supplement. Be skeptical. And people should be skeptical. If somebody has been publishing for 20 years, denying and arguing against the importance of teaching kids how to read the words through a phonics emphasis approach with phoneme awareness and decodable text, and they've been arguing that this is dangerous and counterproductive and it's going to turn kids off to reading and all that stuff, and then they turn around because they're losing market share and put these patches on. Well, you know, why would you buy into that? And so the best way for the consumer to be aware is to do more homework. Unfortunately, you know, we don't have a lot of sources out there that publish reliable reviews. And even now I'll really get into trouble, but the What Works Clearinghouse method for reviewing programs, I'm very critical of it because what those reviews do not consider is all the evidence that shows that something is not effective. So if a publisher claims that their program is effective, they're not critical enough about, well, what was the comparison group and what did they do? And in comparison to what is this effective? And did they do the study design to just make this program look good and manipulate things? And, you know, there are lots of ways that publishers can engage in pretend studies. intervention research is expensive to do well. It's very difficult to do well. So the best thing for the consumer to do is to really know what they're looking for. And I think there's a lot of good guidance coming from entities like the Reading League and so on that give you a lot of information about what to look for, and some good textbooks like Kilpatrick's and so on that give you a good idea of what to look for, and just, you know, hang your hat on that.
Thank you. So there's two other questions. One, I believe, is an easy one. It's going to dovetail into a question about the simple view of reading. But someone was asking if you could give the name of the Hoover and Tumner book.
That's it. Cognitive Foundations of Reading and its Acquisition.
So there you go, Melissa. So here it is, and we can put it in the chat for you. So speaking of the simple view of reading, there have been, one of our colleagues had shared a question about the fact that there have been some pre-recorded trainings where people are trying to align the three cueing system to the simple view of reading. These are entities that are supportive of balanced literacy, whole language methods. How do you see the three cueing system aligning with the simple view of reading?
It doesn't. And it doesn't because, and it never did. And you have to realize that the three cueing system idea came out of nowhere. You cannot find a scientific paper that references it, that uses it as a model. It's sort of been floating out there, associated with several, you know, major enterprises. And the way, here's the problem. It doesn't clearly convey what I illustrated before with the Sonnenberg-derived four-part processing system, that the role of context in word recognition is very minor. The role of context is to help us, once we have named a word that is attached a pronunciation to it through phoneme grapheme mapping, through orthographic mapping, we have named the word, then context helps us determine how it is used meaningfully. Context does not drive word recognition, and that's why when we're testing kids for word recognition, it is most important to give a word recognition test where there is no context. You have kids reading words in a list and reading nonsense words in a list to see if they know the code and if they can read words out of context, because those skills predict reading comprehension. That's why you do it. So there's the problem with context. The other major problem with cueing systems is that they've never had a role for phonology in that model. It never existed. So we have MSV, right? V for visual. And that visual, what they call visual, what somebody has called visual, conveys to the teacher the erroneous thinking that I tried to talk about before with the little kid who could draw, you know. And it leads to drawing outlines around words, color coding words, you know, embedding words in pictures, these things that are unrelated to me, to the phonologically based skill of decoding. So that to me, actually, that's the worst aspect of it, is that teachers who've embraced it have had no reason to understand what phonology is, the role of phonology in learning to read and write, or that phonology is something that exists separate from, but in coordination with learning orthography. and has led to all these mistakes and all the stuff about, well, if you just point to the words and say them, that they're going to get imprinted on the back of the brain, you know, through repetition. Have I said enough about that? I think so.
Yeah, we appreciate your candor. So this probably will be our last question now that it is 5:25. What do you say is what is the role of motivation in students teaching a child to read?
Yeah, that's a great question. So, and there are a few studies, now I can't name the ones I've read recently, but what they say to me is that most kids really want to learn to read, and being unable to do it and becoming frustrated leads to resistance, sense of failure, and lack of motivation. All of us are wired up to be motivated to things that we feel we can do. And the more successful we are, the more motivated we are. And it's just so thrilling to me to see little kids in a structured language classroom who finally kind of figure out how to read a word and how to read something on their own without the pictures needing to prompt them, and how thrilling it is and how accomplished they feel when they kind of get it. That's the key. Success is the key to motivation. And that requires a skilled teacher.
Thank you. So we have 4 minutes left, just a couple of housekeeping announcements. First of all, Dr. Moats, thank you so much for your time. This was amazing, and we appreciated the gift to be able to ask questions and the thoroughness and candor of your responses. It was just wonderful. I know you can't hear everyone, but I'm going to speak for everyone. And many have entered in the questions and in the chat box, many thank yous and kudos and affirmations to your responses. We also have an evaluation for people to fill out. So if you are willing, Melissa Nantes is dropping the link to the evaluation in the chat box. We would love it if you would take an opportunity to click on that link, complete the evaluation. And just a couple of upcoming opportunities that we are certainly offering for our Michigan colleagues as within our Technical Assistance Center. We are gonna have a webinar on Monday at 9:00 in the morning, focusing on the targeted and intensive MTSS professional learning opportunities that would be accessible to districts, ISDs, schools. And some of the things that we are going to talk about, which lend nicely to what Dr. Moats was referring to, we're going to talk about an explicit instruction series that we're going to have. It is a targeted technical assistance opportunity led by Dr. Anita Archer, focused on explicit instruction to increase access and opportunities for all students. And this is going to be a series that will occur over a course of several sessions that will also include a component to work with school administrators and being able to use an explicit instruction observational look-for checklist. Anita will be working with administrators and other teacher leaders and coaches to really go in and talk about how to support the implementation of those elements of explicit instruction. And that is just one of the targeted MTSS technical assistance opportunities, but a couple of others that align with a document that we, myself, Sharon Vaughn, Hank Fien, Gary Troya, Michael Coyne had written. It's Intensifying Literacy Instruction, Essential Practices. And the very first essential practice is the importance of people understanding the learning progression for developing skilled readers and writers. So we have some targeted technical assistance options that are focused on developing skilled readers. And we are going to dig into kind of the word recognition components of the simple view of reading. And we're going to be doing that through some professional learning opportunities for letters, language essentials for teachers of reading and spelling. And that is something to really help to begin to develop teacher knowledge in how reading progresses, because we cannot successfully deliver intervention if we aren't knowledgeable in how to develop skillful readers and writers. So I just want to give a nod to those things. More information will be coming, and these things will also be in our technical assistance catalog. Dr. Moats, do you have any concluding remarks in the last minute we have together?
Well, I'm just very happy to learn more about what you're doing in Michigan. Congratulations. I'm just happy to hear it. And I'm glad I can be a part of building some interest and momentum around your initiative. I wish you all the best.
Thank you so much. Have a nice evening, everyone. We're right at 5:30, and it was just a gift for you to spend your time with us. Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye. Thank you so much, Dr. Moats. Thanks, Melissa and Claire.